Yes, and start it back up again because we're frozen on the camera now. Just do it in the taskbar. Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I'll be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and that there are gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This simply means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or a good encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Yahweh Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, He instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where He showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Later on, He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as He really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations and ages. Through the dispensations of time, excuse me. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Hortense Crozier Perfect. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the first chapter of Romans, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Crozier Perfect.
Good evening. Let's bow our minds in a moment of prayer. Dear Yahweh, thank you for allowing us to see another day. Thank you for allowing us to come to class to learn something about your purpose and plan. Please keep us in this gospel and do not let us stray. Those that have gone astray, see that they can come back to class because this is the only place to learn the truth. All these I ask in your name. Hallelujah.
Caught up in a world they say happened by chance. They wanna believe that it's all in their hands. They try to convince me they shape their own destinies. But if they knew Yah like I know Yah, they'd get down on their knees. Yes, if they knew Yah like I know Yah, they get down on their knees. They don't know He's in complete control. Elohim is running this show, yeah. He's in complete control. Elohim is running this show. Freedom of choice is the law they're spreading around. Divine intervention is nice if God is ever around. They don't wanna believe their every step was patterned by Him, that He's got it wrapped up tight, line upon line. They're going back to spirit again. He's got it wrapped up tight, line upon line. They're going back to spirit again. They don't know He's in complete control. He told Jeremiah, I made you a prophet long before this earth had shape without form, before it was void. Yeah. He said, I possessed your ways before I made the deep blue sea. I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. Yes, I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. They don't know He's in complete control. Elohim is running this show, yeah. He's in complete control. Elohim is running this show. He's Alpha Omega.
Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson for this evening will be Romans, the first chapter, page 201, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Romans, the first chapter. Saul, a servant of Yahshua the Messiah, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of Yahweh, which he had promised afore by his prophet in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son, Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior, who was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of Yahweh with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the call of Yahshua the Messiah. To all that be in Rome, beloved of Yahweh, called to be sons, grace to you and peace from Yahweh our Father and Yahshua the Messiah. First, I thank my Elohim through Yahshua the Messiah for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For Yahweh is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making requests if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of Yahweh to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was hindered hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other nations. I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the other nations, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah, for it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jews first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of Yahweh, revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of Yahweh shall be revealed from heaven against all impiety and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew Yahweh, they glorify him not as Elohim, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible El into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore Yahweh also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of Yahweh into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. For this cause Yahweh gave them up unto vile affection, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one towards another, men with men doing that which is indecent, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was proper. And even as they did not like to retain Yahweh in their knowledge, Yahweh gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, and whisperers, backbiters, haters of Yahweh, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parent, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of Yahweh, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but consent with them that do them. I have read Romans, the first chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Crozier Perfect, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. So today is our open testimony slash lecture night. So at this time, I would like to ask if anybody would like to give a testimony or a lecture this evening. Anybody who would like to volunteer, please come forward, whether here or with us on Zoom. I'll give a couple of moments for a response. Okay, so I would like to call for our first speaker, Dr. Hortense Crozier Perfect.
Good evening again, everyone. Good evening. I've been going over Moses down in Egypt. Pharaoh had put out a death decree, and Yahshua and Moses both were born under that death decree. Moses' mother hid him for 3 months, and when she could no longer hide him, she put him in an ark and had his sister to follow him down the Red Sea. Pharaoh's daughter was bathing, and she seen the ark, and she pulled it out and seen that Moses was in it. Now, she knew he was a Hebrew because the male children, Hebrew children, had to be circumcised on the eighth day. She raised him up in Pharaoh's house. He became like a prince. One day, he was walking about, and he seen brother, which was Aaron. He killed that Egyptian, and he looked all around, didn't see nobody, and he buried him in the sand. The next day, when he was out, the Egyptians were asking him, were they going to kill him like they did the one the day before? So he knew the word was out. And the Egyptian that he killed, I can't remember if it was Pharaoh's son or Pharaoh's grandson that he had killed. So he left Egypt. He had been there 40 years. And he went down in the land of Midian. He seen some girls at the water well, and some men were messing with him, and he interceded, and they invited him back to their house. And he ended up marrying the oldest daughter. And he was on the backside of the mount, and Yahweh called him up into the mount. And he went up into the mount, and Yahweh told him to take off his shoes, for on the, where he stood was holy ground. And Yahweh gave him the Ten Commandments. And when he came back down, he seen that Aaron and the children of Israel had taken the gold and stuff that they had, and they had made an idol. And they were worshiping the idol, and Moses broke through those tablets down. Then Yahweh called him back up, and he gave him the tables of stone, the Ten Commandments again. And he showed him the days of creation. And Yahweh told Moses that he was to go back down in Egypt because he was going to bring the children out of bondage. And Moses was afraid because he stuttered. But Yahweh told him that his brother was going to meet him, and his brother would do the talking for him, which was Aaron. So they go to Pharaoh, and he asked Pharaoh to let the children of Israel go. And Yahweh hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he wouldn't let the children of Israel go. After so many times of this, Yahweh told Moses that he was going to send plagues down. The first three were on the Israelites and the Egyptians, and the last seven were on the Egyptians alone. Moses told the children of Israel that they were to take blood and put it on the top of their doorpost and on the sides, and it was to drip from the basin below. And the death angel would pass by, and all the firstborn would be killed. And they said it was a bloody mess because they had bodies everywhere that Yahweh had killed from them being disobedient. And we always say that Moses was the one that brought the children out of Egypt, but Yahweh was the one that brought them out. And the Red Sea parted, and they went over into dry land, and they were in the wilderness of Sinai. I can't remember if Moses went up a third time, and that's when he seen the days of creation. He seen the tabernacle pattern, which was Yahweh Elohim. And the days of creation were broken down so that Moses could see them. But when Yahweh spoke it, it was all done at one time. But it was broken down into days and nights so that Moses could understand. And John seen it from the end to the beginning. I can't think of anything else right now, so I'll relinquish. And with that, hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Crozier. Perfect. I'll be your next speaker for this evening's class. I appreciate the remarks from the previous speaker, and it's important for us to set a good solid foundation when we're going into this discourse here, so that those who are coming to seek and find and know Yahweh have some place to start with. And that's why I really appreciate where Heart Tense started at, is because we must start at Moses. There wasn't a book until Moses received a divine vision and revelation from Yahweh. There was nothing written. And as the previous speaker said, Moses was born under a death decree in Pharaoh's household, ultimately ended up slaying an Egyptian, which was Pharaoh's son, and he feared for his life because he was raised up in Pharaoh's household. He was like unto royalty, but he had limitations, him being a Jew or a Hebrew, if you will. So upon recognizing and it being made aware that he, it was known that he slayed the Egyptian, he fled through the way of the trade route into the wilderness of Sinai, where he met Zipporah, his wife, at the wells, feeding the flock, her father-in-law, Jethro's flock of sheep. And she was being evilly entreated by some unsavory characters, and she, since Moses had seen her getting treated badly, he saved her from them, and she made it home early that day. And her father was surprised and asked why, and she said an Egyptian ran off the people who were bullying her, for lack of better words. Jethro said, okay, well, why didn't you invite him to come home for some supper? You know, at least that's the least you could have did. So she went and found him and brought him into their home. And Jethro was pleased with Moses and offered up Zipporah as his wife. And Moses accepted that offer and took on the job as the shepherd for Jethro's sheep, therefore relieving Zipporah from having to go out there and deal with those people out there who were making it hard on her in the first place. So 40 years go by as he's doing his duties as a husband, tending to his family and to his father-in-law's flock of sheep. And as a previous speaker just had mentioned, he came to the backside of Mount Sinai, and he was tending to the sheep, and he seen a great sight while he was on the backside of the mountain. He seen a bush that was burning in the desert, but it wasn't being consumed by the fire that was engulfing it. So it was a special thing. And he turned aside in his mind, in his consciousness, to see this great sight. And when he turned aside to recognize that something special, something out of this world was happening, Yahweh held him, the angel of Yahweh, as it said in the book. We can get it if you want. Just pick it up at the bush when he turned aside to see the great sight. That verse right there. Three.
Four.
Okay.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet. For the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Now it's important to know that the place that he stands on right here was holy ground, because it outlines the pattern according to a geographical map standpoint. Because this area down here in Egypt is likened unto the outer court. I believe the name Egypt means darkness. And when and Moses was down here in this land, in darkness, in this outer court type area, and he fled out into the wilderness of Sinai, and he was out here for this 40 years, and this place was holy ground. Now, if you back up to the promise that was given to Abraham, Abraham was promised that he would, his seed would receive Canaan's land. And that was the promised land. And that's likened unto the most holy place. That's the final destination for those Jews or the children of Israel that were to inherit this land that was up here. So you've got three different lands that we're speaking of. And this chart, which we call it the Moses chart, we also call it the migratory chart. These three different lands show, according to the pattern, the most holy place being Canaan's land, the holy place being the wilderness of Sinai, and the court roundabout being Egypt. And then both all three of these places are separated by a body of water, by a river. And those are likened unto the veils that are in the tabernacle. The Red Sea divided Egypt from the wilderness of Sinai, just like in this tabernacle we have here, the court roundabout. Once you're in the gate and you're inside of this tabernacle, you go into the court roundabout. Before you can get into the holy place, you have to go through the door to the holy place. And the holy place and the most holy place are covered with a veil of sheepskin, lambskin, and badger skin. And it covered all around the holy place and the most holy place. You had to go through that first veil to get into the holy place. And that is likened unto the Red Sea in this migratory pattern that we have right here. Now, I just wanted to make that clear why Yahweh Elohim is telling Moses on the backside of Mount Sinai to take off the shoes from off his feet because the place wherein he stands is holy ground. In this school in the moderation, we said that we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern that we're talking about and that we're making this correlation with. So we want you to be aware of that as we go on and speak on the journeys of Moses and the children of Israel. I'll continue reading there in Exodus, please.
6. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters.
Hold on for 1 second. If you just turn that down just a little bit on the soundboard, that might reduce the echo that's coming in. I apologize. There may be an echo coming in on YouTube. I speak kind of loud, so my voice comes off of the speakers a little bit, and it's picking up, and we still have some tuning to do on our audio. Now, here back in the scriptures that we're reading, Yahweh is saying that he has surely seen the affliction of his people that are down here in Egypt. Now, what we want you to know is that he really did see the affliction of his people because he was made manifest down here in Egypt.
Right.
He was Joshua, son of Nun. There is no record of any lineage of a tribe of Nun or that comes from the loins of Abraham named Nun. But nevertheless, the minister
son of Nun. And this is Nun after the flesh. This is Yahweh, our Elohim, being made manifest in the flesh, coming in to institute this covenant that he would ultimately give to the Jews and to the Jews only. And he is, at this time, speaking to Moses, this Joshua son of Nun, astral projecting from down here in Egypt through to or out of this burning bush. And this is actually happening in the confines of Moses' mind. So there wasn't really a bush that was burning. If anybody would have been here with him, they would not have seen this. But moving on, he's seen the affliction. He's surely seen the affliction of his people by reason of their taskmaster. Please read.
For I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
He is come down. He's not coming down. Right. He's there. Read, please.
And to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Now this is that land, Canaan's land, that we spoke about, that he said to Abraham he would inherit this land. And he is come down to deliver the Jews out of the bondage in Egypt, up into this land that was promised unto them. Read.
Unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites.
Now, if you had any skepticism about what land it was flowing with milk and honey, he outlines the people who dwell in the land. The Canaanites, the Jebusites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Hittites, so on and so forth. They were all up here in this land at this time, in Canaan's land. And he's saying that he's going to lead them up out of Egypt to inherit this land that's already being occupied by these other nations. Continue to read, please.
Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptian oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt.
Now Moses is getting the job. He's saying, come now therefore. He's saying, come down into Egypt, because the person who's speaking to him at the time is down in Egypt, which is Joshua the Messiah, which is known in the book as Joshua, son of Nun. But this is a school. And in this school, we know that in the Hebrew language, there is no letter J.
Right.
Or there is no character in that language that produces the sound made by the letter J. And the closest thing to what the J would be in the Hebrew language is a Y. And they tried to take that Y and turn it into an I. And then they, because there was just
a language barrier when the scribes translated the scriptures into Greek and other languages. And they use an I instead of a Y. And ultimately corrupted the name and took it away. And the reason why they took this away is because bad things happened to them when they disobeyed Yahweh using his name. So they didn't want to use that name anymore. They didn't want to use anything like it. So that's why you got Joshua. That's why you got Joseph, that's why you got all of the J's and so on and so forth. Yes, Dr. Salas.
At that time, they called him Ochia. Ochia, not Yahshua. Ochia.
Dr. Salas made a statement at this time. They called him Hoshea. And they did. And there was a time where it was differentiated between Hoshea and Yehoshua in the scriptures.
When they went to spy the land, Yahweh promised them is when they changed his name into Yahshua.
Yahoshua. You should have said that on the mic. But we'll get to that if time will. Nevertheless. He says, come now. Right? Can we continue reading right there?
Okay. 10. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto Elohim, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly, I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee, that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve Elohim upon this mountain.
When you bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, you will serve them upon this mountain, Mount Sinai, that he's at right here, at the base of this mountain, looking into this bush that's burning and not being consumed. Continue to read.
13. And Moses said unto Elohim, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said unto Moses, Eyah Asher Eyah. And he said, thus shall I say unto the children of Israel, I will be, has sent me unto you. And Elohim said, moreover unto Moses, thus shall I say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob has sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations.
Now Yahweh gave Moses a description of who he is, Eyah Asher Eyah, which means I will be what I will to be. And then furthermore, he gave him his name, Yahweh. And he outlined, just like he outlined what this Canaan's land was by the people who inherited it, he also outlined who Yahweh was the father of, the father of Abraham, the father of Joseph, the father of Jacob, so on and so forth. Now, he is the Yahweh of all of these people, the Elohim of his fathers, and his name is Yahweh. And this is the first time right here in Exodus where any man had ever heard the name of our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And after he gave Moses this name, he told Moses that this would be that his name would be a memorial unto all the generations. That escapes nobody. We're never supposed to take that name away. But yet still, it's been done, as we were just referring to with the scribes, transcribing, taking away the sound of the name and translating it into something that means absolutely nothing. That's just totally against the commandment of Yahweh that we'll get to. But yet still, this is where the name of our Heavenly Father comes from. Now, if you're going to get to know anybody, the first thing that you want to do is, hey, what's your name? Hey, how you doing? You know, I've met a lot of people, and I'll have a long conversation with them, maybe two hours. And then all of a sudden, before I leave, I'll be like, hey, man, what's your name? Like, I'm sitting here talking to you all this time, or hey, lady, what's your name? So at least I know who you are if I ever see you again. I know, you know, hey, I talked to this person, their name was such and such. Well, you don't know anybody if you don't know their name. Oh, just a personal note. You know, I would go out as a child and I would talk, you know, I would get into something and I'd come back home and I'd say, you know, me and my friends were doing something and then my mom or my dad would say, well, what's their name? And then I'd be like, and my mom would be like, they're not your friends if you don't know what their name is. And I remember that stuck with me. I'm sure if any of you out there are parents, you may have said something like that to your children coming home talking about my friend did this, my friends, or whatever. You know, like, and you don't know their name, they're not your friend. Anyhow, because a friend is somebody who you have an intimate relationship with. That doesn't mean it has to be sexual or of nature. A lot of people, when they say intimate, they think, oh, you got to be hugged up, kissing, and no, that's not what, no. Intimate is close, very close. You know their, you at least know their name. You know what they like. You know what their favorite color is. You know what they don't like. You know what they like to talk about. You have some things in common with each other. You know, you share interests. And you help each other out. That's what friends do. But, you know, you just meet somebody on the street. You don't even know their name. And you just got them having a good conversation. You can't hardly call that person your friend. That's an acquaintance at best. But we want to have, this is a school, and this is a place to learn something about your Heavenly Father. So I'm going into this great detail about knowing the name, just to show the relevance of how important the name of Yahweh is. And now we are telling you what his name is. You read in the King James Version, and Moses says he asked the Lord God what his name was, and then the Lord God said the Lord God, which is like a dog chasing his tail around. He's not giving him any more information than what he had before when the Lord God tells him what his name is. He asks the Lord God what his name is, and then he finds out, oh, it's Lord God. That's wrong. When you look at the text where it says Lord, you'll notice that the way that it's spelled is different than all of the rest of the text surrounding it. That Lord is in all capital letters. And the reason why that Lord is in all capital letters is because that's giving reference to the original script that was there, let me put it that way, which was Yahweh, or the Tetragrammaton. Now, in Hebrew, they don't speak with vowels. In English, we need vowels to speak. And the first man, Adam, the masculine creature of mankind, the only vowel that was in his name was the Yeh. The first woman was Eve. The only vowel that was in her name was E. We place that A in the Yah, which is the masculine portion of our Father's name, our Heavenly Father's name, and we place the E in the second part, the Way, which is the feminine portion of our Heavenly Father's name. And that name in Hebrew, that Yahweh, means one, he who causes to exist that which exists. Thank you. Now, we've got the name now. Skip over into Exodus 6 and 2, please. Thank you.
Exodus 6 and 2. Mm-hmm. And Elohim spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am Yahweh, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, as El Shaddai. But by my name Yahweh was I not known to them.
And Yahweh appeared unto Moses' fathers as El Shaddai, which means Almighty Provider. They didn't know his name, though. Abraham, Jacob, or Isaac, none of them know the name of Yahweh. That just confirms that Moses was the first one to get that name. Now, back in the third chapter, we're not going to read through all that, but Moses was given miracles to perform. He was to throw down his rod before Pharaoh, and his rod would turn into a serpent. And when he would pick it up by the tail, it would turn back into a rod. He was supposed to smite the waters down there in Egypt, and they would turn into blood. What was the third? Oh, and then he was to put his hand into his bosom, and it would turn leprous. And when he put his hand back into his bosom, it would return to his regular flesh. And these were the first preliminary miracles that he was supposed to perform before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh, and entreat Pharaoh to let the children of Israel go. But Yahweh told Moses that Yahweh would harden Pharaoh's heart so that he would not let the children of Israel go. And ultimately, Yahweh would pour out 10 devastating plagues onto the land of Egypt down here. Those first three plagues, like the previous speaker said, affected both the Jews and the Gentiles, or the Egyptians. And then the last seven plagued the Egyptians alone. And that tenth plague, that the Passover, that death angel passing over, they had to take out a lamb of the first year, and it had to be without spot and blemish. They had to hold it over. They had to take it out on the tenth day. They had to hold it over for 4 days and examine it to make sure that there was nothing wrong with it. It didn't have any defects. There wasn't any worms coming out of it or anything like that. It had to be clean and innocent, if you will, without spot and blemish, as yes. And they had to kill this lamb between the evenings. And they had to drain the blood, and they had to strike the blood on the four corners of their doorposts of their houses. They could not break a bone in this lamb. And then they had the rest of the blood that was in a basin. It was kept in a basin. They had to roast this lamb with bitter herbs, and they had to make unleavened bread to eat. So they had lamb on the menu, they had bitter herbs on the menu, and they had unleavened bread. They had to consume of this entire lamb in the night of the Passover, that this death angel would come over, and they had to do this with their loins girded, with their shoes on their feet, and wearing their clothes, because they had to be prepared to flee up out of the land of Egypt when this plague came over this land. Now, if the household did not specifically follow the rules of how to prepare this lamb and have this lamb in them and have it on the blood on the door, then the firstborn in every household would be killed. And if you had the blood on the door and the lamb in you, then your house would be spared. Now, outside of those Hebrews who had that lamb in them and on in the blood on the door, there was not a household in the entire land of Egypt that didn't have something dead, whether it be from their cattle, whether it be their firstborn son or daughter. Something was dead. It was death in astronomical numbers down here in Egypt. And it was sore. The Egyptians were very, very sad after this thing happened. And this allowed Israel to spoil the houses of the Egyptians for the golds, the fine linens, and the different raiments. And they packed in the morning. They hurried up. They spoiled the Egyptians for all of the things that they could carry with them. And they made their way to the Red Sea. And when they got out of Egypt, on their way to the Red Sea, Pharaoh and his army got so mad that he had his army come follow after Israel And they caught up to Israel because they had horses and chariots. His army was equipped. So they caught up and barreled down on Israel on their way to the Red Sea. And as Israel approached the Red Sea, Pharaoh and his army approached them. And Israel was scared. And they said, why did you bring us out here to the base of the Red Sea to be killed? We could have died out in Egypt. And Moses turned to his minister Joshua and looked at him and said, hey, therefore stand and see the salvation of Yahweh. Which that's what Joshua means. Is Yahweh is salvation. So he tried to take He tried to take the credit off. He didn't want to do it anymore. He didn't want to go down there in the first place. When Yahweh commissioned him to go down there, he kept making all kinds of excuses. He started saying, I'm a stutter. Yahweh Elohim said, hey, your brother Aaron's down here, and he speaks quite eloquent. So let him be your mouthpiece. You know, and all of these different things, all of these different reasons why he didn't want to go back down here. He finally gets down here. He does all of these things and comes to this Red Sea, and he can't take it anymore. Hey, what are we going to do, Joshua? All right. He said, what you looking at me for? Raise up your staff and part the Red Sea. So Moses raises up his staff, and the Red Sea divides. It heaps up. And they can, Israel goes through on dry ground. And the cloud, there's a pillar of Yahweh that comes down and it goes before Israel and behind Israel. And it's in this cloud, this pillar is, it's a cloud during the day and it's a pillar of fire by night to Israel. And it's darkness unto Egypt, unto Pharaoh and his host. Now Israel goes down into the divided waters of the Red Sea, five by five across, and they go through this divided water of the Red Sea, and Pharaoh and his host, they follow behind. And Pharaoh and his host, his army, when they're in this divided water, the water closes in on Pharaoh, swallows them up, and they all drown. When you look in the Charlton Heston movie, at the end of the movie, Pharaoh goes back down into Egypt to take care of his family, and they're down here, talking about the Lord God is truly the Lord God. But it's right there in the book that he was overthrown in the Red Sea. Him and his host was overthrown. There was no more Pharaoh after this incident at the Red Sea. He was dead and gone. And when the children of Israel got over to the other side, it's in the book that they seen the bodies washing up on the shore. Now, Israel is out here in the wilderness, and they, as it was said, it would be a token unto them that when they brought out this land, that they will worship Yahweh at the Mount Sinai. So this is what happened. They were told to prepare themselves. And Moses was called up into the mount. And when Moses was called up into the mount the first time, Israel wasn't allowed to come or touch the mount. Not a beast of the field, nothing was allowed to come up onto this mount. It was just Moses alone that was going up here. And when Moses got up here, he was given the Ten Commandments. Yahweh thundered down the Ten Commandments. And in that Ten Commandments, Exodus 20 and 7, which since we're talking about the name. But let's just, no, let's start at 1. We want to get down to 20 and 7. But let's start Exodus 20 and 1, please.
And Elohim spake all these words, saying.
This is the first trip in the mount. After the children of Israel are brought up across the divided water of the Red Sea. Now, before I go on, I want you listening to this to read this book of Exodus. Don't just believe what I'm up here talking about on the floor and say, oh, this guy's really smart, and he knows a lot about the Bible. He's not even reading out of the Bible right now, and he's just talking about the whole story. That's because I had to read the book, and you have to read the book too. You have to read and review the report and make sure that the things that any of the instructors at this school are saying are accurate and true. Please read.
2. I am Yahweh thy Elohim, which has brought thee out of the land of Egypt and out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no Elohim before me.
Don't have any Elohim before you. Don't have any Elohim before him. We don't want any God put before Yahweh. Please read.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idol, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath.
So is there an exclusion there with the crucifix that you wear around your neck? Because that's the Son of God. So can we do it because it's the Son of God? Can we just make the graven image? And what about the praying hands? What about the cross? What about the fish that we put on the back of our cars? What about worshiping these books, the Bible? You know, I've been to people's houses. They got a Bible sitting up on a podium, you bet not touch it. It's got the gold around the leaf of the edge of the paper and everything. You bet not touch that book. Anyhow, go ahead. Don't make any graven image. Don't make any idols unto Yahweh. They're Elohim. That's what it's saying, right? But we do it. That's what they're doing in Christendom all the time, and he's telling them not to do it. 3.
Or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters under the earth.
Oh, so that the fish is out. Okay, let's go.
Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them.
Oh, I see him falling down to the crosses all the time in the church. Why are they doing that? I see them worshiping the Pope, making him an idol, like you got the American Idol, the contestant show where they go up and sing. They make the Pope unto the idol just like that. They worship him, he's the vicar of the Son of God, right? Read, please.
For I, Yahweh, thy Elohim, am a jealous Elohim.
Yahweh is jealous. So he doesn't want anybody next to him. He doesn't want you using anything to worship him. Give me John 4:24 real quick and hold where you're at. Yahweh is a jealous Elohim. It says right there.
John 4:24. For Yahweh is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Yahweh is spirit. And if you're going to worship Yahweh, you must do it in spirit and truth. That's why it's a necessity not to make graven images or idols or light incense in the name of Yahweh or God or anything like that. Go ahead and read, please. Back in Exodus.
For I, Yahweh, thy Elohim, am a jealous Elohim. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me.
Okay, so for the sake of time, let's skip down to the seventh verse where he talks about his name.
7. Thou shalt not take away the name of Yahweh, thy Elohim, to bring it to naught. For Yahweh will not hold him guiltless that taketh away his name to bring it to naught.
And that's a very sad and very scary thing right there. Because he's telling them not to take away his name. But that's exactly what has happened. And when I came into this school and I found out that the true name of our Heavenly Father was not Lord and God, and I used to make fun of Lord and God. Because I thought to myself as a child, who doesn't? How can the name God, like our Heavenly Father, the most supreme being, you turn his name around and it's a dog? And you know, some people kick dogs. I mean, a dog speaking? I mean, it can't even hold a conversation with you. But our Heavenly Father, God, or dog. And we find out that God is just a title, and it's meaningless. And every God must have a name. Every Lord must have a name. So don't take away that name of Yahweh and replace it with Lord God. Just because your pastor thinks it's the okay thing to do, and somebody wants to sit up and over-explain to you for an hour why the names were changed, it's right there in the book. It says don't take it away. And it doesn't matter how long somebody could talk to me until they're blue in the face explaining why it was changed. At the end of that, I'll say, well, you were wrong, because the book says don't do it. Okay, so we're getting to know something about our Heavenly Father. He was giving them a law out here in this wilderness assignment. Now, they were in darkness down here in Egypt. Now they have light out here in the wilderness assignment. They know something about the name of their Heavenly Father. They know something about what their Heavenly Father wants them to do. And there was manna that was available for them to eat, and quail that was available for them to eat, that they didn't have to work for any of their food that they was out, that they had out there. And they were given this tabernacle as a kingdom, as an intercessor between them and their Heavenly Father while they were out there. And this was told to them on the second trip. Now, let's skip over to the 24. And pick it up at 1. Okay. I'm going to try to get to
24 and 1. And he said unto Moses, come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
Moses alone shall come near Yahweh. Read.
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him.
Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders shall not come up unto Yahweh, only Moses alone. That's the rule. Read.
And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh and all the judgments.
Now Moses came and told all of the people down here in the wilderness what he's going to do. Come up onto the mountain. This is the second time. All right? What did they say?
And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which Yahweh has said will we do.
They said, okay, this is what we're going to do. Go ahead and just continue reading right there.
And Moses wrote all the words of Yahweh and rose up early in the morning and built an altar under the hill and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel.
All right, so Moses wrote it all down. And then he built an altar with 12 pillars representing the 12 tribes. Read.
And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offer burnt offerings and sacrifice peace offering of oxen unto Yahweh. You want me to drop down to 9?
We can go ahead and they sacrificed the offering and they sprinkled the blood of the offerings on the book, and that was making a covenant that they would do what Yahweh commanded them to do, for Moses to come along, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders to go too, and all of this thing. That was their way of saying, we're going to do this. Okay? Now skip on down to 9.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
Now we're on our way up the mountain. Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Now Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, that 74 people saw the Elohim of Israel. Right? Mm-hmm. All right. Read.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness. It was clear. There was no mistaking that shape and form that they saw, all right? Mm-hmm. And it was divine as the body of heaven in its clearness. Read.
11. And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
He had hands. Read.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
They ate and drank. Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me and to the mountain, be there, and I will give thee tables of stone, and a law and commandments which I have written, that thou may teach them.
Now they're on the plateau of the mount. And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me. Now at the beginning he said, Moses alone shall come up to Yahweh. Continue to read.
13. And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua. And Moses went up into the mount of Elohim.
Read.
And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us.
Tarry ye here for us. Why is Joshua raising up and going up with Moses? When Yahweh said, Moses alone shall go up into the mount unto Yahweh. Well, the reason why is because his minister Joshua was Yahweh Elohim that told him to go up into the mount. Moses was down in Joshua's tent, or Hoshea's tent, talking to him when Hoshea told him, all right, you're going to go up into the top of the mount. Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu is going to be nine, and then the 70 elders will be lower than that. And it's just going to be you alone coming up here with me, okay? And then when it gets down to it, Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders, they go up here into the mount, and Hoshea, or Joshua, the son of Nun, transfigures, and all of these 74 see Joshua transfigured into Yahweh Elohim, and they see the body of heaven in his clearness. And then Moses is called up into the top of the mount to go up alone. And he said, tarry ye here for us until I come again to you. That's where we're at now. Continue to read.
Tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you.
Read.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Mm-hmm.
If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them.
Read.
And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount.
Now Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon.
And the cloud covered the mount 6 days, colon. Now, there's no explanation after this colon, but there should be an explanation of what comes after the colon. We know that what comes after this colon is Genesis 1 and 1. Read Genesis, just pick up Genesis 1 and 1.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
In the beginning of the vision that Moses is having up here on the top of Mount Sinai on his second trip, Yahweh Elohim created the heavens and the earth. That's what you're seeing. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on upon the face of the deep. Read.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Read.
And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light. And
read.
Elohim saw the light, that it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness.
All right.
And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night.
Now we know that Elohim called, he divided the light and the darkness, and the light is called day, and the darkness is called night. And read.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Was the first day. Now, we were just over in the 24th chapter, and it says that cloud of gold on top of Mount Sinai, 6 days, colon. And then there's no explanation of what happened in those 6 days. But when you go back to Genesis 1 and 1, it explains the first day, the second day, all the way down to the sixth day. Can we get the sixth day and just read at the sixth day in Genesis, first chapter?
And Elohim said,
what verse is it?
I'm starting
24. Okay. 1 and 24?
Yeah.
Okay.
And Elohim said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after their kind, and it was so. Mm-hmm. And Elohim made the beasts of the earth after their kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the ground after their kind. And Elohim saw that it was good.
Okay.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens.
Now Elohim said, let us make man in our image. And this is what he did after he made the birds of the sky, the fish of the sea, the beasts of the field, the cattle, and all of that other stuff. He made man very last, after he put the sun in the sky, after he made the trees and, you know, everything that was made, man was the last thing. Go ahead and continue reading about this man and him ruling over the fish of the sea and over the birds and so on and so forth.
And let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heaven and over cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. Mm-hmm. So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he him.
Now Yahweh said, let us. And that's Yahweh, pure spirit, taking on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim. That's the us that he's talking about here. Let us. Because there ain't nobody else besides him. Go ahead and continue reading where you're at.
28. And Elohim blessed him, and Elohim said unto him, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth.
Now he was given a commandment right there to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Read.
And rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. Mm-hmm. And Elohim said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth.
Skip down to 32 in the Holy Name Bible.
Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their hosts. And on the seventh day, Elohim completed his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made.
Now, this was the sixth day that man was made. And then on the seventh day, Yahweh Elohim rested from all the works that he did. Now, skip back over to where we were at in Exodus, the 24th chapter, 24 and 16. Mm-hmm.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon.
Read.
And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud because he rested from all the works that he did while he was up there. Right? Now, continue to read.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel.
Now, and there's other places in the scriptures where Yahweh is described as a consuming fire. Isn't devouring synonymous with consuming? Yes. So Yahweh does not change, but that's just for a reference point for other things that we're going to talk about here in the future when you come back to class. Continue to read where you're at.
And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Now, there's no explanation right here where what was up for 40 days and 40 nights. Oh, wait a minute. Yes, there is. You skip over to the next chapter, right? Go ahead and start reading 25.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the offering which ye shall take of them, gold and silver and brass, and blue and purple and scarlet and fine linen and goat's hair, and ram skin dyed red, and badger skin, and cedar wood,
mm-hmm.
oil for the light, spices for anointing oil, and for sweet incense,
Three.
Onyx stones and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them.
And he said, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them.
According to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it.
Now, Moses was called up into the mountain. He was up on this mountain the second trip for 40 days. And the first 7 days that he was up on the mountain, he would show the creation of the universe in a vision. And then for the remaining 33 days that he was up on the mountain, he would show the structure and function of this tabernacle pattern in great detail. And when you're reading the beginning of that 25th chapter right there, Yahweh is preparing Moses to tell the people what to do to start constructing this tabernacle. When you read on for the next five so on chapters,
up until the 33rd chapter,
it's all about the structure and function and the construction of this tabernacle that they were made, that they were told to make out here in this wilderness. Skip on down to the last verse of the 25th chapter, please.
40. And look that thou make them after their pattern, which was showed thee in the mount.
Mm-hmm. Look, they look that you make them after the pattern that was showed thee in the mount. You will show, and this is everything. You want to see that everything is made after this pattern that's shown to Moses up here in the mount. Where is it at? Is it John 5 and 43 where he says, beginning at Moses? When he says, Yahshua the Messiah began in Moses to explain the things concerning himself.
Five.
40.
Is it John?
Yeah. Is that where it's like you search the scriptures for them? You think you have? All right, just start at 39 then.
John 5:39. Mm-hmm. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me.
Yeah, you search the scriptures, which is the books that Moses, the first five books that Moses wrote, and then the other consecutive 34 books of the prophecy, the law and the testimony. And what is that? What's the, hold on one second. Isaiah 8:20. Hold where you're at in John.
To the law and to the testimony.
These are the scriptures that they had at the time that Yahshua the Messiah is walking the earth plane saying, ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and there they will testify of me. What does it say to the law about the law and the testimony?
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there's no light in it. And Yahweh told Moses to see that everything was made according to this pattern. So the law and the testimony has to be made according to this pattern that was shown up in the mount as well. And that's why we in this school tell you that everything in the universe is made according to this pattern. But go ahead and rip back where you're at, John.
Can I interject?
Go ahead.
This is a good point in that. In Hebrews 8:5, you have Saul speaking to the Hebrews, talking about we who serve unto an example of the shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of Yahweh when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, said he, that thou makest all things according to the pattern showed thee in the mount. Just to bring home the point of the fulfillment of what the tabernacle was pointing to, and that they're talking about that in the so-called New Testament.
Right.
And also Stephen speaks of our fathers had the tabernacle of witness as well, of Elohim being with them.
Right. Yahweh does nothing without witnesses. He does absolutely nothing without witnesses. And that's why we're going through this. And we're hoping that you see that Yahweh operates according to a pattern throughout this creation so that we can point you back to our Heavenly Father, because that's our end of this school. And that's the only end that we have in this school. And that's the way that the founder said. Now, when we go through the moderation and we get to the aims, we say this is the 10 aims and objectives. But there's really only one aim. And that aim is the first aim. And that is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. And there's 10 objectives to go to that. That first aim is also an objective, and all of the rest of those aims are things that we do in this school as an objective to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. I'm not standing up here going through this migratory trek and what and the people, places, and things that Israel went through just to show you how much I know about the Bible. I'm doing this so that you can see how Yahweh operates according to a pattern, if you can see it, if Yahweh wills you to see it. John 5:39, please.
You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me.
This is Joshua saying, it testified of him. That was written about Joshua, the whole thing. Nothing else. It wasn't written about nobody else. Go ahead and read.
But ye will not come to me that you might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
They won't come to Yahshua the Messiah because they're too busy of trying to obtain to their own righteousness. They're too busy trying to do themselves into following these laws, statutes, and judgments, and looking at their neighbors, trying to catch them doing something that they're not supposed to be doing, or something like that. And they're not coming to Yahshua, and he knows them, that they don't have the love of Elohim in them, because he is the love of Elohim. Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, which is Joshua the Messiah. and his only begotten son died the death of an outcast dog down here in Golgotha for the sins of the world. That's how much he loved the world, that he died willingly, was buried, resurrected, and tarried and outpoured his Holy Spirit according to the scriptures, according to what we have down here beginning at Moses. And aren't we getting to that part right there in John where he says that? Because that's what I was looking for.
Two more verses.
Okay, go ahead and read. I know that you have not the love of Elohim in you.
Now,
that's why I had her start up at 39 to go through this, because he come in his Father's name, and it's important. That name of Yahweh is important. And we explained that Yah is masculine. So his son had to come in the masculine portion of the name of our Heavenly Father, Yahshua, which means Yahweh is salvation. And read that again. I am come in my Father's name.
I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not.
They don't receive Yahshua. But what?
Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. All over your Sunday broadcast on television, they'll worship Buddha. They'll worship Allah. They'll worship Henry Clifford Kenley if you give them an opportunity to. But they won't worship Yahshua. Read. They trust in Moses. They trust in Moses. They believe all of this that was thundered down from the mount. They believe all of the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that were given to them that were written down in the first five books of the Bible that we call the law or the Torah. They believed all of that. They trusted in that. They followed that around all the way. 656 years was it? From where Moses was given that law down at the mount all the way. 1490. I'm sorry. See, I get the numbers mixed up sometimes. But from the time that Moses was given this law and they were given that covenant back here in Egypt, all the way over to Yahshua walking the earth plan for 33 and a half years. They followed that law of Moses. They trusted in that. That became like their, it was second nature to them. They got used to it. It became a custom and a tradition to where they, I'm moving around. They believed in that thing. Let's go ahead and read. Moses, who you trusted, I won't accuse you to the Father. Go ahead and read where you were at. Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father, that there is one that accuses you, even Moses, and you trust. For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if you believe not his writings, how shall you believe my words? Moses wrote of Yahshua the Messiah, but Moses didn't write of Jesus. Moses didn't write of Buddha or Allah or any of anybody else for that matter. Moses didn't write of H.C. Kim. Moses didn't write of Sean Hutchinson. Read.
And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned?
There, he didn't go to school with them. He wasn't up in their, you know, in their classes with the scribes and the Pharisees doing all of the things that they did. But this was the Holy Spirit. And Yahweh has power. So Yahweh has the power to make known all of it. He created everything. He confused the tongues of men in Babylon. So how can he bring all of himself back together into his own son? Where did he start to preach at?
Yahshua answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me.
His doctrine is not his own. Because they're up there trying to figure out where he got all of this information from. He's like, this doctrine ain't from me, but it's from him that sent him. Gave him the knowledge. And that's what we read over in the first chapter of Romans today. That which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them because Yahweh showed it to them. That's how Yahshua knew all of these things that he needed to know. Because Yahweh made it manifest in him for his purpose, to draw out his purpose. Because that was the Lamb without spot and blemish. He didn't need nobody to come and teach him anything about his heavenly Father so that they could corrupt it and mess it up. He got it straight from the source himself. Continue reading.
50. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine. Whether it be of Yahweh, or whether I speak of myself, he that speaketh of himself speaketh his own glory.
But if any man do the will of Yahweh, they shall know the doctrine of Yahweh, whether Yahshua the Messiah down here preaching is doing the will of Yahweh, or if he's doing his own will of himself. And this is what we do in this school, is we endeavor to show you that what Yahshua was doing for the 33 and a half years that he walked the earth plane, 3 years in his ministry, he was that lamb set from Yahweh to make atonement for the sins of the world that were brought in by way of this covenant that was given, which made sin exceedingly sinful by this tabernacle that they had with the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. To the Jews and the Jews only, not to the Gentiles. Wasn't no Gentile ever told to get in any water. Wasn't any Gentile ever told to get circumcised, to wash their feet, to do any of these carnal ordinances. This was for the Jews and the Jews only, and none of them could do it. But Yahshua the Messiah came in the likeness of sinful flesh, and he fulfilled all of these things, taking them out of the way and ushering in a new covenant. Oh, my goodness. I just wish I could bring these words with the things that is on my mind right now. Continue reading right where you're at.
51. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him.
Yahshua the Messiah, you don't read in a book anywhere where he's trying to get credit to himself for anything that he was doing in the time that he was walking the earth plan. And then the same thing we got towards the founder of our school. He didn't want any credit for any of the things that he taught down here. He wrote a book, two books, two verses of the same book. He had all of these charts drawn out. He went on three ecclesiastical peace missions. He preached for 45 years, all the way until his death, preaching Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua the Messiah. And anytime anybody tried to give any credit to Henry Clifford Kinley, he told him, no, not so. He said, all praise be to Yahweh. He said, yeah, he didn't come to save nobody. Henry Clifford Kinley didn't come to save nobody. Yahshua the Messiah is the one who came, save somebody, save you. The covenant, the new covenant, the New Testament is already in play. And it ain't in your book. It's written in the hearts and the minds of men that know the doctrine of Yahweh or Elohim, like Yahshua is speaking to the scribes and the Pharisees right here. And you know, if you know it, if Yahweh reveals it to you. You know it. You know if it's Yahshua talking his own stuff or if it's or if he was trying to get some credit as his glory to himself. Continue where you're at, though.
52. Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keep it, the law?
That's what he said. That law was for the Jews, and the Jews only they could keep it. Read.
Why go ye about to kill me? The people answered and said, thou hast a demon who goeth about to kill thee. Yahshua answered and said unto them, I have done one work, and ye all marvel. Moses therefore gave unto you circumcision, not because it is of Moses, but of the fathers, and ye on the Sabbath day circumcise a man. If a man on the Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken, are ye angry at me because I have made a man every whit whole on the Sabbath day?
Luke 24 and 27. Pick it up at the beginning of the train of thought, though. That was good that we read all that right there because it shows that Yahshua is talking about those laws that those Jews had that they couldn't keep. And Yahshua himself was coming in to keep those laws. He was doing these things that they couldn't do. And that's what he was explaining right there. But go ahead and pick it up in the train of thought there at Luke 24:25. Okay.
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of hearts to believe all that the prophet hath spoken. Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?
The Messiah is to suffer the things of the law to enter into his glory. All of them. Read.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Now this is after Yahshua died, was buried, resurrected, and they were up there. They were up there like, oh, they just stole away the body out of the tomb. Where are you at? Where are you going? Oh, and they mourning Yahshua the Messiah, who was healing all of these people and doing, performing all of these miracles and things. Now he approached to him and he says, oh, fools of slow of heart, ought not the Messiah to suffer all of these things, suffer this death, take off that flesh, and to enter into his glory? Now, they were down here in darkness in their minds. Now Yahshua, he resurrected a quickening spirit. Just the same way that Moses saw Yahweh Elohim appear out of the midst of this burning bush, Yahshua the Messiah appeared to the multitudes after his death, burial, and resurrection. Same, self-same. This is super incorporeal. And he said, ought not the Messiah suffered these things and to enter into his glory. And then he began to preach the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, beginning at Moses. I know we're almost out of time. And beginning at Moses, the name, the pattern of the tabernacle, the laws that was given to them, the prophecies, all the way, Joshua, all the way down to Malachi. Jeremiah 31 and 31, please, and I'll be done.
Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers.
That Moses was given this covenant, not according to that covenant. Read.
In the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt.
Read.
Which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them.
Isn't that what Yahshua was just saying over there in John 5th chapter? Read.
Said Yahweh, but this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, said Yahweh.
After those days that the Messiah ought to suffer all these things that he had to go through. Now, hold that thought right there and pick up Matthew 5:17 and then get right back over where you're at in Jeremiah.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Read.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or the smallest part of a letter shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled.
Ain't nothing going out of that law until the whole thing is fulfilled. And that's what Yahshua the Messiah came to. He suffered all of those things to enter into his glory. And Yahshua the Messiah, he prophesied, Yahweh, through Jeremiah, prophesied that after those days, after he fulfilled that entire 613 statutes and judgments, he would usher in a new covenant, and that's what we read in there right here. Go ahead.
I will put my law in their inward parts.
You're going to write it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
Nope.
Read.
And write it in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people.
He will be their Elohim, and they shall be his people. Read.
And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know ye Yahweh, for they shall all know me.
So you're not going to search the scriptures in them thinking that you got righteousness anymore. That's what you're not going to do anymore. You're not going to be looking at your neighbor saying, you shouldn't have did that because that's against the law. Accusing your brother. Because Joshua said, I'm not going to accuse you. There's one that accuses. Even Moses, who you trust. Read.
From the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh.
Everybody's going to know him from the least of them to the greatest of them. Read.
For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more.
They will remember their sin no more. This is what Yahshua did in his ministry. He fulfilled that law. That's why when he went to John the Baptist and John refused to baptize him, he said, suffer to be so because thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. And that's it had to be done according to the scriptures. and you read over in, what is that, 1 Corinthians 15 chapter, we're out of time, it says, moreover, brethren, I preach, I declare unto you the gospel that was received of him, how Yahshua the Messiah died, was buried, and resurrected according to the scriptures. It wasn't according to how you feel. It wasn't according to anything like that. It was according to the scriptures, according to the pattern of the universe. And we'll get back onto that in the next class. All praises be to Yahweh, our Elohim, through his only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That'll conclude today's class. Time goes so fast. Can I have that announcement there? We have an announcement. Thank you, Dr. Love. So the service for Dr. Johnny Hernandez will be on March 7th at 11 a.m. at 9645 Magnolia in Riverside, California, 93503. That's the funeral home where the service will be at. The burial will be at 1:45 p.m. and that will be held at 22495 Van Buren Boulevard in Riverside, California, 92518 at Riverside National Cemetery. And again, that will be at 1:45 p.m. for those of you who may want to attend that service. All right. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7 p.m. From 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. And on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is where you can learn something true about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Great class. Sean, can you send me the link to the first song, How Great Thou Art?
I didn't start that music. How great thou art. Okay.
Yahshua, you are so wonderful. Bow before your man.